As I'm sure many of you know, General Motors Corporation is celebrating 100 years this business year. As a proud GM dealer for 37 years, it is my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker. But before I do that, we'd like to take this opportunity to wish GM a very happy birthday. Wow, what a history. By 2000, job of keeping GM a world leader in automobile manufacturing. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Rick Wagoner.
Well, thanks very much, Dale. It's really great to be here giving a speech on my birthday. Actually, I can't think of a better way to celebrate the day. In fact, I'm looking forward to our small cocktail party tonight for about 4,000 GM dealers. And why not? It's not every day you get to celebrate your 39th birthday. But don't let my age fool you. I've actually attended the NADA convention every year since 1994, soon after I returned to the U.S. from living in Brazil. This event is one that I just don't miss. In fact, I really look forward to it. And I appreciate the tribute for GM's 100th anniversary. 2008 is the great history and tradition that we share, and the fact that we're part of an industry that really makes a difference for so many people in so many different ways. So thanks for the video, and even more for the sentiment behind it. Now, back in 2001, when I had the pleasure of keynoting this session, I talked a lot about change, about how fast and how far the industry was changing, and how we together, dealers and OEMs, had to work hard to keep pace and take advantage of the opportunities that change can bring. And I made a prediction that day that the rate of change in our business would continue to accelerate. Believe me, I had no idea. In fact, it reminds me of a story. It seems that there were two hunters out in the woods one day and they came across a huge hole in the ground. The first hunter says, "That's some hole. I can't even tell how deep it is." The second hunter says, "Let's throw something in there and see how long it takes to hit the bottom." So they scrummage around and they find an old transmission lying under a nearby bush. Count 1, 2, 3 and heave it into the hole. Suddenly there's a tremendous rushing sound and a goat comes roaring through the brush, runs up to the hole and without any hesitation whatsoever jumps right in. Well, the two hunters are standing there trying to figure out what the heck just happened. And a farmer walks up and says, "Hey, you fellows didn't happen to see my goat around here anywhere, did you?" First hunter says, "Well, funny you should ask that. We were standing here a minute ago when a goat came running out of the bushes at about 100 miles an hour and jumped headfirst into that hole." Farmer said, "Impossible. I had him chained to a transmission." Well, maybe that's not exactly the kind of change you were thinking about, but I have to tell you, there have been moments over the last few years when I knew exactly how that goat must have felt. And seriously, when you think about it, it is pretty amazing, pretty incredible, really, to consider all the challenges that we faced over the past 7 years. Challenges that no one could have ever predicted, like 9/11. Challenges from outside our industry, like $100 a barrel oil. Challenges from within the industry, like bankruptcy among some of our biggest and most important suppliers. Economic challenges like the one we're experiencing even right now. Some challenges specific to domestic OEMs, things like runaway healthcare inflation, huge legacy costs, and even a few rumors about bankruptcy. And of course, challenges for dealers, like profitability and industry consolidation. And all that's just here in the U.S. If you'd asked me in 01 if we'd face all these challenges in so concentrated a period of time, I'd have said, right, like what are the odds of all that happening? Kind of like having an undefeated season in the NFL, and we've seen how slim the chances are of that. But as I mentioned earlier, in my 2001 keynote, I talked about us working together. And we've actually faced up to many big-time challenges since then by doing exactly that, working together. A great example of something that we've been working on for some time together now is the Automotive Youth Education System Program, or AES, which was actually introduced at this meeting by my predecessor at GM, Jack Smith, back in 1995. Jack proposed the then audacious idea that OEMs and dealers should actually join forces together to create a new kind of apprentice program in this country to meet our industry's needs for skilled service technicians and offer young people new career opportunities. As I recall, at the time it wasn't greeted as enthusiastically as some of us had hoped, probably because a lot of people thought that competing dealers and competing OEMs couldn't come together on much of anything. But we did, and thanks to the leadership of a lot of people throughout the industry, OEMs, many dealers, NADA leaders, especially people like Phil Brady, who currently serves as chairman of AES, this program is now available in 45 states. Since 1995, 4,500 dealers of all brands have participated in AES, and together we've made a difference in the lives of 13,000 young men and women who have gone on to work as skilled automotive technicians. And in doing so, we've helped our industry too. Just a great example of what's possible when we focus on what we have in common and what we can do together to make our own industry stronger. Another important area we've been working on together is the ongoing consolidation among automotive dealers. By the way, I read Dale Willey's comments about consolidation in this week's Automotive News and have to say that I agree with his general premise. At GM, we believe that the decision to close or consolidate dealerships has to be a mutual decision between individual dealers and their OEMs. Our goal is to ensure that those dealers who choose to leave the industry do so with dignity, and that in every market, we work with our dealers on a franchise footprint that improves their throughput and profitability. We want our dealers to be consistently profitable so that you can invest in world-class facilities and a top-notch workforce. That's in everyone's best interest. And my sense is that most other OEMs are thinking about this in a similar way. So let's keep working together on this matter so important to both of us by realizing that each situation is in fact unique and by finding mutually agreeable ways to consolidate when it's in everyone's interest to do so. This brings up another shared interest, and that's dealer profitability. At GM, we established a little while ago with our National Dealer Council a joint dealer profitability task force to address what is, of course, a very important dealer concern. And thanks to the work of that group, we were able to announce in December an increase in dealer margins and an increase in our wholesale floor plan. This wouldn't have happened as quickly or as smoothly if it weren't for a commitment to open communication and innovative thinking from both sides. This type of progress is something that we've seen a lot more of over the past 7 years, and something we can continue to improve in the years to come by working together. Now, going forward, maybe the most important area that dealers and OEMs can work together is our effort to reduce the growth in U.S. oil consumption, U.S. oil imports, and greenhouse gas emissions. This is a really hot issue today, and one that I think is going to be front and center for a long time. Over the past year or so, we, as an industry, work with legislators and regulators in Washington to help craft the energy legislation that President Bush signed into law in December. The new legislation includes some important provisions that we supported, things like separate regulation of cars and trucks, a 35 mile per gallon CAFE requirement by the year 2020 for cars and trucks combined, CAFE standards based on vehicle size and weight, and the extension of flex fuel credits. It's fair to say that the new legislation is unlikely to have included at least some of these provisions had it not been for an industry-wide education and lobbying effort, phone calls, letters, emails, face-to-face meetings. And that would not have been possible without the critical role played by automotive dealers and the NADA. Now, don't misunderstand. The new legislation sets some very tough national targets, a 40% increase over current fuel economy requirements, a 30% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions, both by 2020. We're going to have to work very hard to meet these levels. In fact, the work that it's going to take to meet these requirements remind me of a story about a cowboy who appeared before St. Peter at the pearly gates. St. Peter asks him when he arrives at the gates, "Have you done anything of particular merit?" Cowboy said, "Well, one time for sure. There was the time I came upon a gang of bikers who were threatening a young woman. I told them to leave her alone, but they wouldn't listen to me. So I went up to the biggest, meanest, toughest looking biker in the bunch, tore off his bandana, threw it in the dirt, yanked off his sunglasses, and kicked over his bike. I looked at the others and I said, 'The rest of you guys back off, or I'll let you have it next.'" St. Peter was pretty impressed. He said, when did all this happen?" The guy said, "Oh, just a couple minutes ago." So, okay, we're going to do the right thing. We in the industry are going to be part of the energy solution. But unlike that cowboy, we do want to live to tell the tale. And to achieve this, we're going to have to do something that this industry really hasn't done since our infant days 100 or so years ago. And that is to bring successfully to market a range of new propulsion technologies, and this time to a much more demanding consumer base with much higher expectations of quality, durability, safety, and so on. At GM, we're making massive investments now and have been for a number of years in technologies that make our vehicles more energy and environmentally friendly. Gas friendly to gas free, as we say at Chevy. Flex fuel vehicles, hybrid vehicles, electrically driven vehicles like the Chevy Volt or our Chevy Equinox fuel cells. And other OEMs are doing similar kinds of things. As we bring these next new technologies to market, we'll literally change the way people think about transportation and the way they think about our industry. Frankly, it's an opportunity to change our business for generations to come, for our children and for our children's children. This is a huge assignment, for OEMs and really dealers alike, as we work together to develop the technology, bring it to market, educate consumers, and sell and service these advanced propulsion vehicles. As I look at it today, I see two areas in particular where we, dealers and OEMs, need to work together right now to ensure that we achieve the future that I know is possible. First, we need to work together very closely to ensure that we have the right regulatory environment to allow us to focus all our efforts on reducing the growth in U.S. oil consumption, U.S. oil imports, and greenhouse gas emissions. These are crucial issues with a lot of public support. In fact, a number of states, in their zeal to address these issues as completely as possible, are anxious to go even beyond the aggressive targets set by the new federal energy legislation. And we understand this desire. But the fact is, we have to focus our efforts, if we have to focus our efforts on meeting state targets instead of a single national standard, which is already very aggressive, is going to be tough to meet, then we're not going to be able to accomplish everything that we otherwise could. By fragmenting our efforts, we'll only make it that much harder to achieve the end results that we all want to see. So what can we do to address this situation together? In short, we need to work together to educate policy matters, policymakers at the state and local levels on the importance of tough but national standards. Standards that also allow for us to continue providing the economic and societal benefits that we've provided our communities for many, many years. A second thing we need to work together on to ensure that we achieve the full promise of our efforts to reduce oil consumption, oil imports, and greenhouse gas emissions is to foster the creation of the infrastructure required to implement the energy solutions that we will bring to market. Simply put, to win with technologies that are now within our grasp, we as a nation need to provide the infrastructure necessary to make them actually work. We'll need charging stations to support electrically driven cars and trucks. We'll need a hydrogen refueling infrastructure to support fuel cell vehicles. And today, we need ethanol pumps to support the millions of flex fuel vehicles that Americans are already driving right now. Seems intuitive, a real no-brainer. And yet we see, for example, how hard it can be to make this happen, even when the solutions are relatively easy. Take E85, for example, where we've essentially taken the chicken out of the chicken and egg problem. We OEMs have already produced a lot of flex fuel vehicles, and we're producing a lot more every day. And the production of E85 is ramping up rapidly, including breakthroughs in more efficient, inexpensive, and environmentally friendly ethanol. But we're doing a lousy job as a nation in making this E85 available to our customers. In fact, ethanol fueling stations today represent less than 1% of the 170,000 gas stations in the U.S., despite our best efforts to grow this number. Working together, dealers and OEMs really need to push for faster expansion of ethanol fueling stations to realize the tremendous promise of E85 ethanol in reducing our nation's reliance on imported oil and reducing greenhouse gas emissions. So to wrap it up, what I'm talking about today, really much as I did 7 years ago, is an appeal in this time of continued great change for dealers and OEMs to continue to work hard at working together to shape our industry and create the kind of future that we know is possible. We're fortunate to work in a great business with great traditions, great products, and really great people. It's an industry that really is different, and like you, I feel honored to be able to play a part in it. We have the ability in this business not just to build and sell great cars and trucks, but we really have the ability to create the conditions and the technology to solve big problems, create a better world, in fact. Add the fact that over the last several years, the domestic manufacturers have undergone tremendous restructuring and find ourselves in a vastly improved position to compete here in the U.S. and around the globe. And I think we stand at the start of one of the most dynamic times our industry has ever seen. And in times of dynamic change, success comes to those who lead. And together we, dealers and OEMs, can lead our industry to new highs. I look forward to doing just that with all of you in the days and years to come. Thanks very much. I wish you a great convention.